Good morning, everybody. So, this morning, what I will try to do is to show what are the relationships between the two ways of building a theory, the D'Alembert way, which has been described by Francesco Zola yesterday, and the Cauchy way, which is a well-known way to describe the continuum theory in the classical case of first gradient matter. So I want to show that the two ways achieve the same results and are equivalent way of describing the theory. So it is, some parts are rather technical, but I will skip the computations because it's very difficult to follow and replicate computation on slides. It's easier on the blackboard, but the blackboard is too small for this purpose. So I will skip the technical steps. So I am from Toulon, so just some words, because yesterday Samuel described many structures, and among these structures, Toulon was not present. And there is a reason for that, because Toulon is too small for the new trend of structuring research now, because it's out of Shanghai ranking, of course, too small for that. So it is forgotten by the CNRS, by all important structures.
No, it was only Paris. It was Lyon, wasn't it?
No, actually, yes. So
you are
Italian.
Yes, but then somehow hidden inside, hidden in the Cosevita system. Just to say that in France and maybe elsewhere in Europe, there are small villages still resisting again and again. Okay. So the I will do, I try to put it on one slide, but it's the limit for that. So it's a long introduction to explain, to emphasize that action, internal action in a material has to be described in the framework of distributions. So it will be examples starting with forces, well-known forces, and couples, surface couples, double forces, and a speech about the fact that there is no uniqueness for the representation of a distribution. And this is a fundamental problem which makes a difference between Cauchy and D'Alembert approach to the description of internal actions in the matter. Then I will introduce the two ways, the one of Cauchy and the one of D'Alembert, then describe how you have to make the computation in the D'Alembert setting and how you have to make it in the Cauchy. I say Cauchy null because the null theorem is important here, the Cauchy null approach. And how they are reconciled. And then, if I have time for that, to show what the results are going to be the first gradient is 1, 2, 3, and they will stop at 3 because you will see it's intricate. I wanted to write this sentence called phase one, and indeed I knew only the first part of the sentence and how everything is increasing nowadays. It is 1000 fois sur le métier ou 100 fois sur le métier répétez votre pas. And generally we stop there. But the whole sentence is 20 fois sur le métier, remettez votre ouvrage, polissez-le sans cesse et repolissez-le, ajoutez quelques fois et souvent effacez. So this was written in the 17th century by Nicolas Boileau, which was writing advices to new writers of poetry. So I think that this sentence is important not only for poets, but maybe also for scientists. So I have looked on the internet for translation of this sentence, and the proposed translation is very poor. thing is, if you don't succeed, try again. It's not the real sense of this sentence. So I prefer to try to translate it word by word. So 20 times on the loom, but your work, polish it incessantly, polish it again, had sometimes and often errors. And indeed, I wanted to write this sentence because it is what we have done with Francesco dell'Isola, years after years, writing and writing again.
Likely you discover that it is 20 times, not 1,000.
But maybe we have done it more than 20 times now.
Yeah.
And indeed, you will see that here I have again polished a little bit last week. But searching for the translation, I found other citations of the same text. And there maybe have some application for scientists. So the second one is, before writing, learn to think. And indeed, as now the trend is to write many papers per year, maybe it would be good to have this sentence in mind while doing research. Another one which is well known and well used frequently is ce que l'on conçoit bien s'énonce clairement et les mots pour le dire arrivent aisément. What is well understood can be clearly formulated and words for telling it will come easier. I think it's good for scientists. And the last one is not very kind. It would be rather a Mason if that's your talent. But there is many others in this room. So, let me now come to the introduction. Mechanical interaction are distributions. So, let us start by forces, because forces are the basic concept in mechanics. So, what we know is that forces are, in general, fields, vector fields, which are applied to the continuum. We well-known body forces, we are used to surface forces on the boundary of the domain, but yesterday we discussed about the possibility of having a line force, a line density of forces somewhere on the edge or inside a smooth surface, and we can also discuss about the possibility of having point-wise forces on a system. So there is a mathematical concept which includes all these types of forces, which is the concept of measure. You have measure with different type, with different dimensions, which are vector-valued measures, meaning each component of the force is a measure, and this measure can be a measure distributed in the volume. We say a measure absolutely continuous with respect to the volume measure, or with respect to the three-dimensional Hausdorff measure, it's equivalent. But you can also have measures which are absolutely continuous with respect to the two-dimensional Hausdorff measure, to the one-dimensional or discrete measure. So this is also the way of writing pointwise forces as an integral. The question was raised yesterday. If you understand forces as measures, even point-wide forces are measures, then you can write the integral of u times the measure, which is a force. So the sum can be written also as an integral. So a measure can be seen in two ways. One is the abstract way, starting from the set theories, and the other one is to see the measure as linear functional applied to continuous field. So to any test field u, in mechanical, you think that u is a displacement, and then we'll speak about virtual work, or you can think that u is a velocity field, and then you think about virtual power. But from the mathematical point of view, it's only a test field, which is a continuous function u. And to know what f is, what is the measure f, you compute the integral of u df for all possible u.
Can you explain for non-mathematicians what a measure is? An engineer is not allowed to learn that.
Okay, so I say that you have two points of view. So the easiest point of view is the dual one, saying that a measure is a linear functional over continuous fields. So you take the space of continuous fields, you have a linear, continuous linear functional over it, which is a measure. So it is written here. To any function u, so it's capital u, you associate the integral of df.
So that it's an angle where you can take the integral from.
Yes.
Could be a function that could be distribution or something else.
A special distribution. All distributions are not measures. Yeah. All measures are distributions. Distribution of order zero.
Okay.
By order zero, we mean that in the functional, when you write the integral works only directly on u and not on the derivative of u. Okay? So, the measures you can have in mind are the volume measures, meaning a field distributed in the volume, the surface distributions, which is vector fields on the surface, and when you integrate with respect to the area, the line distribution and the pointwise distribution. So if it is a pointwise distribution, the integral only means you may take the sum of u at the point where the forces are applied times the force at this point, and you sum it. I have no time here and I have not prepared a lesson on
sigma
measure. So it's a longer story.
One U is capital and the other
is
small.
It's an error. It's a capital U everywhere. So I think that this dual point of view, meaning the point of view saying looking at measures as linear functional, is easier to deal with. And doing this, you naturally include measures in distributions. They are special distributions. Okay, even in the classical, so the two last points are related to a question which has been raised yesterday. So what about forces concentrated on the line or at poles in continuum mechanics? So in Cauchy theory, it is forbidden from the very beginning. Because in Cauchy theory, you say forces acting on the boundary of a domain are force per unit area. You cannot have line forces in the theory.
If you take a distribution,
you don't have distribution in Cauchy theory. It's the very beginning of the theory. Forces are some forces per unit area on the boundary. So, anyway, you can, afterward, when you have the Cauchy theory, you can extend it formally, and you can use forces concentrated on line and on points, even in points, it's not forbidden. And you have solutions which can sometimes be interpreted as actual solutions of some elastic or some problem, but sometimes only as mathematical tool to get some kernel to integrate afterwards to have a solution to more. So it's forbidden by the theory, but anyway, you can sometimes deal with them. But there is another fact which is often mentioned with the previous one, which is that it sometimes some materials forbids line forces. Not because of the theory, because of the constitutive law. For instance, if you are in linear elasticity, then you cannot, a linear elastic material cannot sustain a force per unit line. If you try to apply a force per unit line on an elastic, linear elastic material, what will happen? You will have for almost, for a very small amount of elastic energy, you can make a huge displacement of the line. So you can have a huge external work done by your external line force, but paying a very small amount of energy in the elastic potential. So this means that if you try to find the equilibrium, you try to minimize the potential energy of the system, and you don't succeed because you can find displacement with lower and lower energy tending to minus infinity. And so you don't have any convergence, you don't have any solution. And if you try to do it by finite element, for instance, then you will get something which is mesh dependent. The smaller is the mesh, the higher will be the displacement of the line. So this is a well-known fact. If you try to cut an linear elastic material with a string, then you can do it. You pull the string down, and the line will go down inside the linear elastic material. So this is a phenomenon which is due not to the theory, but to the constitutive law of linear elasticity. If you are out of linear elasticity, for instance, if you have an elastic energy which is at the power 4 of the strain, instead of power 2 of the strain, then you can sustain line force. You can even sustain point wave force. This is really due to the constitutive law of your mechanics. So if you are in non-linear elasticity with an energy of this type, so sorry, but I write the strain tensor as E of U instead of symmetric part of the gradient of U. The same thing. Okay, so everywhere in my type, I will use E of U. So, forces are well known. Here I want to give an example which is, I think, not often used. What I call an expansion strain. So, you try to minimize a linear elastic potential energy, so a quadratic functional of the strain tensor, and you act on the system with a mechanical action, external mechanical action, capital E, which is applied not on you, it's not a force, but on the divergence. So this is a well-posed problem. What happens if you minimize that? What is the mechanical interpretation of E? So, the left-hand side is classical elastic energy. What is the external action applied on the system? It's something which tends to increase the divergence of E. So, it is something which tends to expand the material. So, I interpret E as an expansion strength. So, it can be due to different physical factors. For instance, if you are heating a part of your material, it tends to expand. So I can interpret E as a thermal force which tends to expand the material. But it can also, you can also think about a porous medium with you have a gas inside the pore and you are increasing the pressure of the gas. So the matrix, the porous system, will tend to increase. You have a force which tends to increase the volume of the material. But you can also have some biologic system in which are acting somewhere and tend to increase the volume of your material. Okay, so there are different ways of acting on the material in this way. And this is a well-posed problem. And this can be easily included in the Cauchy theory, even if in the building of the theory in general, we don't think about such actions. That there is absolutely no difficulty to include this action in the theory. So this action is a first order distribution. It is a linear functional which acts not directly on you, but on some derivative of you, divergence here. So it is a first order distribution, which act inside the body. So, I think that the fact that we often do not consider such action is due to the fact that we can write it in a different way. So So you can integrate by part the divergence of U, and you get the gradient of E times U inside the body plus the boundary term. So you can reinterpret this first order distribution inside the body as the sum of two terms, a driving force inside the body, here, gradient of U, gradient of E, is now a body force, like the direct evolution, plus a force, a pressure on the boundary. So this is a completely equivalent way of writing the problem. The interpretation is different from the mathematical point of view. You have replaced a first order distribution by two zero order distributions, one in the body, one on the boundary. And from the mechanical point of view, you have replaced what I call an expansion strength by two forces, a body force and a force on the boundary. Well, from the interpretation, the mechanical interpretation, it's not quite clear what is the better. If you have some increase of pressure of the gas inside the domain, is it easier to see that as something which tends to expand your material or something which tends to move it if there is some gradient of E and a pressure of the boundary? Just a question of what you prefer. Let me say that I'm not sure that it is better, the second way is better. If you increase the pressure of the gas inside the porous medium and then to expand it, doing this transformation here, let's say that E is constant, so you can get rid of the gradient force. If E is constant, then the expansion force is equivalent to a pressure of the boundary. And indeed, if you want to expand uniformly your material, you can act by a tension on the wall boundary, constant tension on the wall boundary. So imagine that you are increasing the pressure, the interstitial pressure inside the porous media, you expand it, you will interpret this increase of pressure as a tension on the boundary of the domain. So it is, I think, counterintuitive. Because you increase the pressure and you interpret it as a tension on the matrix. Okay? So, that is to illustrate the first sentence, polish and polish again the word. So this slide is a mess, I'm sorry. Because when I wrote the first sentence, I was thinking about Cosserat continua, and then my mind skipped, and the next sentence is not about Cosserat media, but about second gradient. So I write. So I wanted to introduce the possibility of having a surface density of couples in some manner. So the first one you are thinking of is the Cosserat, which is one of the fathers of this medium. So, but if you want to say what is a surface density of couples, how it acts on the system, if you are in a Cosserat medium, you just write that you act on the extra kinematical descriptor. So you have the displacement U, and you have some rotation, micro rotation, theta, and what you say is that on the boundary you act on the displacement with the force, and the one about the boundary of the domain F U, plus, and you can also add on theta on the boundary by saying you have an action of this type, C theta. And you say, okay, a couple is something which acts on theta. But at this point, it's just a question of name and vocabulary. because you have two descriptors, u and theta. And it is your choice to say, okay, theta is a rotation. Theta is an extra kinematical descriptor. And it is just a question of vocabulary to say that theta is a rotation. I'm not quite fair here, because there is also something which is different. It's the structure of the descriptors. U here belongs to some vectorial space, while theta here is a rotation, and you cannot, it's not the same structure as vector space. It is something, it's a group of rotation, something different. But anyway, it is a descriptor, and the fact that you call it a rotation is your choice. So this, for me, is a force acting on the descriptor. So a couple, for me, is something which is different. And now I am thinking about a second gradient medium. You can, as it was said by Nicola yesterday, you can think about that as a Coursera medium in which theta is related to U by some internal constraint, saying that theta is related to this Q part of the gradient of U. So if you do that, from the context of a small displacement here, if you do that, then applying the couple to theta means applying something not to the descriptor, the kinematical descriptor of U, but to the gradient of U. So if you have this internal constraint in the Coursera, you change the nature of the medium and you change the nature of C. C here is a zero order distribution of the kinematical descriptor. If you do that, C becomes a one-order distribution acting not on the descriptor but on the gradient of the kinematical descriptor. So a good way to explain that is to say C is working on the gradient of U. In which way? So in general, we write it as C times the normal derivative of the tangent velocity of the tangent displacement. This is a rigorous way of describing the action. And the best way of describing such an action, I think that there is no other way to describe it rigorously, is to give its forward over the density. So, when we say couples, we have in mind what we know about rigid bodies. A couple is two forces acting on a rigid body, two opposite forces. One acting there, the other acting there. And when we think about a couple which is located somewhere, we have in mind that these two points are very close to each other. And at the end, they are at the same point. But the force are very large. So if we make something which will be related to the difference of the velocity of the displacement here, U1, U of. So when you pass to the limit, you are making the gradient of U in this direction. You have in mind something which is the derivative of U in some direction. So the question is it the same to have C times du2 over dx1 or minus C du1 over dx2? So what we know about rigid bodies is that ça va marcher une fois, pas de
problème.
One shot. So it is known in rigid bodies theory that acting on the body like that is equivalent to acting on the body like that. everyone using a screwdriver knows that. But in quantum mechanics, it's not the same action. du2 over dx1 is not equivalent to du1 over dx2. And it's still different from c times du2 over dx1 minus du1 over dx2. So all these actions are different. So if you want to explain clearly what action, what these actions are, you have to describe their body. So you have to describe them as distribution. So as I don't want to make the theory in a purely abstract way, I will show you some microscopic 2D models, 2D just for the simplicity of the drawings, because you can do it in the 3D case too, which are only made by atoms linked by linear springs. So it's trust, only trusses. And I use these models to interpret the what the surface density of couples means, what is the action on equilibrium, and in which case you cannot skip this notion. I want also to emphasize how you can interpret the macroscopic density of couples in terms of microscopic forces. So I will show you this truss. It is a very simple truss, almost the most classical truss, which is made by a square lattice of atoms, in which you have a relationship along the squares and some diagonals. In general, we put all the diagonals and we get a model for a linear elastic to be continuum. But here I have erased the diagonals on one line over two. So what happened in this truss? So I have fixed some nodes on the left-hand side. And this truss has this particularity that you have a motion which needs no energy, because doing this motion here, I don't change the length of any of the bars, of any of the springs. So look at the two first lines. You have something which looks like a reticular beam. All the squares remain square, so the diagonals do not change their lines. And the vertical lines just change their orientation, but not their length. So here I have in the framework of linear elasticity of small displacement. So if you follow a vertical line, you will say, okay, here, let's say, look at the first line, you have here these two nodes. And here you have something to increase. You can say, okay, I need to increase the length of the line to do that, not in the context of small displacement. If you want to have the same truss in the context of large displacement, it's not a problem. You just have to change this node and let it slide along the vertical line. And then everything works, but added to this motion, we have a small spring in the vertical direction. Okay? So, what happens when you try to find the equilibrium of such a truss? If you act on it, right here. So first, notice that as I have fixed a large number of nodes on the left-hand side, then from the macroscopic point of view, this side will not move. Okay, and I do this from the macroscopic point of view, the left-hand side remains fixed. So, what I can do without expending any energy is doing something like that. I can interpret this material as a linear elastic material with no resistance to shear, a degenerated material. But this is wrong. There is a resistance to shear. If you try to do something like that, having a shear in one part of the material but no shear in the other part, then you need to expand, to extend some bar, and you will spend some energy. So you cannot say that you have a material which has no resistance to shear. It has no resistance to a uniform shear, because it's what you call a pseudo-rigid material. Something which has a one-dimensional, here one-dimensional set of displacement, one-dimensional subset of displacement, which is associated to a vanishing energy. Okay, so let me try to find the equilibrium by acting on this side with the surface density of vertical forces. Of course, there is no equilibrium. The right-hand side will go down and down and down in the context of a small displacement. So I cannot find any equilibrium to this system. So how to fix this problem? Okay. I will add some extra fixed nerve on the left-hand side. So now all nodes on the left-hand side are fixed, and I am still pulling down on the right-hand side. Then there is an equilibrium on the truss. You can compute it, it's easy. And if all forces are the same here on the nodes, then the computation is very easy to do, because all the horizontal layers behave independently from each other. So you can do the computation layer by layer, and it's all the same. So you just have to make a computation for one layer. And it is a well-known model for a beam inflection, a beam which is embedded on the left on extremity and which is pulled down on the right extremity. So the equilibrium of such a system is well known. What do you have? You have a transverse displacement with no displacement here, no gradient of the displacement, no rotation on this embedded side, and a curvature which increases, which decreases, which is from here to the extremity here. And the transverse displacement is a polynomial function of degree 3 with respect to the axis. So you have something like that. So all these beams behave in the same way, and the equilibrium has this. So now, how do you interpret this equilibrium in terms of forces? You can do the computation, but the forces which are acting here at this fixed node. So you have, of course, because of balance of forces, you have a vertical force. So to balance F here, I have a vertical force F here, somewhere, the two points. And to balance the couple, I need to have here some horizontal force. Which way? This is correct. So at the end, I must get here a force like this. That, and here the force like that, to counterbalance this force here. And now if you pass to the limit, by having in mind that the size of the cell is very small, or the epsilon and the epsilon stand to zero, you interpret this beam as a line, a force here to balance it, plus a couple here, which prevents the rotation of the beam. So in the 2D case here, everywhere you will have a vertical force to balance the force you are applying here, plus a density of corpus to balance the balance to a rotation of the beam. So you have the equilibrium on the slide, and on the left hand side you have a surface density of vertical force plus a surface density of corpus. And it is completely different from a classical Cauchy continuum, in which if you act here with a force, then you get a surface density of force here to balance it. But to balance the momentum, you have vertical force, horizontal force here, okay, which are distributed along the domain. Here, it's not the case. Here, you have something which is uniform on the left-hand side. And it's not a global solution, but really a local solution, line, horizontal line, parallel, something like that. Now, let me try to interpret the action of the corpus. So I have two forces here, and on the next beam here, I have exactly the same situation. So on this left boundary, I have very quickly oscillating forces. One in this direction, one is almost the opposite. And this for all beams. So something which is quickly oscillating. So from the macroscopical point of view, I interpret this as, from the vertical point of view, a uniform density of force, but from the horizontal point of view, as a density of corpus. So I'll try to do the computation. I say, okay, I have, so this is x2 axis, one axis. I have here. So I'm separating the vertical components and the horizontal components. So let me just just deal with horizontal components.
The horizontal displacement of these points
is not related to the global displacement, horizontal displacement of the material. There is no clear relationship between the fact that these points are moving horizontally in different directions to the global displacement, horizontal displacement of the system. So you have to do this strange transformation to say that acting on these two points in the line here, acting on these two points with two forces like that is equivalent to acting on these two points here with forces like that. Almost equivalent. When epsilon stands to zero, it will be equivalent. It's up to a factor of epsilon as a whole. So, you say, okay, instead of acting on these two points, I prefer to act on these two points. Okay. I could do the same drawing here, and instead of fixing these two points here, I don't fix this one, but I fix this one. It works exactly in the same way. But now the macroscopic interpretation of forces is different. You have now two vertical forces here to balance the momentum of the system. So doing this, you will not have this expression for the forces, but instead you will have vertical forces at two points which are on the same horizontal axis. So when you will pass to the limit, instead of this one, you will find f du cube over d. And this has a real effect on the system. And indeed, if you make a rigorous limit analysis of the problem, the macroscopic model will have this action on the boundary, and of course, not this one, which is not relevant. So what I want to emphasize here is that it is not so easy when you look at the microscopic action to predict what will be the macroscopic action at the limit. Okay. So the way of knowing the distribution by knowing the forces at the microscopic level is not easy.
Yeah, even at zero, so even at zero, the horizontal distribution of the point is zero.
Yes.
So necessarily we have a green white in this form initial, the first one. Necessarily EJ, EJ plus 1, EJ plus 2 are zero.
Yes. Okay. So when I do this, I reinterpret the fixed points by the reaction force which are applied. So you can interpret the equilibrium by saying so you have a Dirichlet condition, the points are not moving, but you can also interpret it in terms of forces only, saying that the forces are such that there is no motion, and you have a purely Neumann problem with forces. Okay. So you look at the system and say, okay, now I look just at the forces which are applied and forget about the fact that they are not.
Another instance in which forces are misleading.
So I think that this model is quite clear because couples and act something which act on rotation is something which is well known for rigid bodies, so something which is not very difficult to have an intuition on them. And now I will go to something which is a bit more difficult to understand, is the double forces. So the double forces are actions of the type, so it is an interval about the boundaries, double forces applied on the boundary of a domain, which acts on the normal derivative of the normal displacement. So meaning that you will pay for the fact that on the boundary, you close to the surface, displace it along the normal of the surface. So you will pay for a local extension here, close to the surface. So something strange. So if you think about that as a limit of a system of forces, it is a limit of two forces opposite but along the same line. And this, we never use that because in rigid body theories, this is zero. This is no action about equilibrium. But in the continuum setting, it has some action. So let me show you on a truss, another truss, but a bit more intricate than the previous one, how you can act on a system with such actions. So this is a truss. For the same, a truss made of a lattice of atoms, not completely a square lattice, almost, and you have linked atoms with their neighbors, and you have erased some links. So it's not quite clear here which are the floppy modes of this system. But I will make it move and you will understand what is the floppy mode. So let me move it. So doing this, there is no change of length of any of the parts. You always, as there is no length, is changed during this motion. So focus on one periodic cell of the system. First, you have this object, which is a base in the system. This object is a rigid triangle. If you don't want to change any length of any bars, then you have the only possibility for moving this is to have a rigid motion. Then you have another one in this direction.
These are pivots?
Yes, that's not pivots. It's atoms with spring-like interactions. So if you think about truss, it's perfect fibers, so it bounces. And then here you have the same. No interaction here, no crossings. Okay? So these two systems share only one node here in common. So indeed, this is exactly the same object than two bars, which are sharing a central node. So they behave like scissors, and we go back to the quantumatic structure that Francesco showed you yesterday. So when you have this structure, you can make the relative rotation of the two bars, and doing this, you extend what at the beginning is a square in a long rectangle. Okay? So you make the extension of the system. So again, this is true only in the small displacement setting because if you see the first vertical line, you will have some things like that. You have some extension of some of the bars, but a small one of other epsilon is over 2. And if you want to make the system work in small displacement for large displacement, you have to replace the nodes by sliding nodes on the left hand side. So now you try to study the equilibrium of this system when you act on the right hand side by horizontal force. Of course, you have no solution. So macroscopical point of view, my material is a square, two-dimensional square. I act on it horizontally here, and it is fixed here because so many nodes are fixed. And there is no equilibrium because you can extend it more and more without any resistance. So if you want to have an equilibrium, you have to fix some models. So you can do that in two ways. Either you fix these two. If you do that, you prevent these two points to shrink, and look at what they do here. So if you prevent that here, then the relative rotation here is forbidden. These two points are fixed, and this propagates everywhere, so everything is fixed. So this is enough to be able to study the equilibrium of the system. But there is an alternative way. Instead of fixing this point, I can fix this point here, and the next one, which is here. Okay? If you fix these two points, you have the same effect. Why? Because in this system, the two points are extending, the length between the two points is extending. If you fix it, then you block everything. Okay? So it's two ways of acting on the system on the left hand side, but this half of order epsilon, let's say 3 epsilon here, so when you pass to the limit, these are action on the left on the boundary. Two ways of blocking the system. So I had on it there. How will be the equilibrium of the system? So computation is more difficult to do, but anyway, you will find exactly the same type of solution that is the flexural means. That means that the energy of the system, in the flexural means, the energy of the system was the integral of some constant k times u2 over the second derivative of the transfer displacement with respect to the longitudinal coordinates at the point. That was for the previous dress. Now it's exactly the same energy, but replacing u2 by u1 here. So we just reverse what was transverse displacement in longitudinal displacement. That's it. From the mathematical point of view, the energy is exactly the same. So the solution, the equilibrium solution, is exactly the same. So this means that if you will have a displacement in this equilibrium, you will have a displacement, which is the solution of the same equation. So it is a third degree polynomial solution with zero displacement on the left hand side, a double derivative on the left hand side, and a polynomial of degree 3. So what you know about beam inflection, you can apply it to compute the equilibrium. So how to interpret the action? So there are two ways, exactly as in the previous example, two ways of interpreting it. You act on the system by playing here, acting two opposite forces here. You insist, you try to shrink this, let's say in the other sense. So you are opposite to a shrink here, so you are opposite to an extension of the system. So if you act here with sufficiently large forces, you can balance the force which is applied to the point. So, of course, this is not enough. You need also an opposite force plus forces to balance this one. So you have two forces, horizontal forces, to balance this one, plus two vertical opposite forces to prevent the extension of the beam. Okay? If you do that, everything is working. But now when you want to pass to the limit, you will interpret these two opposite forms as the derivative with respect to x2 of p2. On this boundary, on this boundary. But again, the displacement vanishes on this boundary. So its derivative with respect to x2 vanishes too. So this is zero. So this has no effect. This is identical to zero on the boundary. So this action has no effect. So from the macroscopical point of view, the action is not this one. So you have to prefer, and I don't tell you how you know what you have to prefer, but you have to prepare the other interpretation, saying that it prevents the extension of the beam. Instead of the two force here, you will say, no, I will instead apply two force here in the next sample node here, opposite. So I will prevent the extension by acting on these two points and preventing the extension of the first interval. So doing this, I will, from the macroscopical point of view, interpret that as the derivative of U1 with respect to X1. And this is the right way of having the macroscopical model for the universe. So that this can be rigorously proved, but this is not so intuitive. So this is a double force on the boundary, and this is nothing. Why nothing? Because if you know U2 on the boundary, let me learn this. So this is nothing new. This is not an action. Just another particularity of this process, this system, is the following. Let me go back to the previous one. This one. What happens if instead of pulling down this side, I pull down on some center line here? So I pull down here. So from the left hand side, it will be exactly the same. So I will find a solution like this. What about the free part of the domain? Think about beams. You are acting on a beam in the middle instead of the end point. What happens for the free part of the beam? You have an embedded beam, and you act here. What happens here? The slope of the beam remains constant. The same way, you will have something like that. Meaning that the free part, in general, in a Cauchy material, the free part has a rigid motion. Here, a free part has a constant shear. Okay? So you have a propagation of the shear, which is here at the limit, in the free part. Now, in the new context here, what happens if instead of pulling it on the extremity, I pull on the center, on the center line? So, from the left part, you will have some extension, but it's difficult to grow because the extension, you cannot see it. It's just global extension. And what about the free part? For the free part, the extension which is here, locally, will be propagated. So to try to grow it, let me grow some spot here, you will have something like that. an extension which is not uniform, which is larger and larger, and on this side we have constant extension. So the beam will go on extending on the double. Something which is a very special of second gradient material, and it cannot be interpreted in the terms of Cauchy measurements.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Maybe this fact that you pointed out, that you have a constant shear and not a rigid motion in the remaining part, is connected to the explanation of the experimental behavior shown by Professor Dell'Isola about the material which only modeled with second gradient is lifted at the extrema, while in first gradient simulations you don't see it.
There is probably some relationship, but there is no free part in the examples.
In that example?
Yes.
The last part of the extrema were not free?
No, I think there is no free part.
The wings which go up.
Sorry.
That one.
The wings which go up.
Yes. Yes.
Maybe not.
Yes. Yes. Yeah, you're right. Yes, you're right. Yes, it is a purely second gradient material, it's no first. Otherwise, you will have some transition layer here, and then you will go back to the rigid motion. So here, I have no interesting range in the system because it is a purely second gradient. Okay. Now, I want to emphasize the fact that you don't have any uniqueness of the representation of a distribution. So, I already showed you an example by when I was speaking about expansion strength. When you have a term in the action which is E divergence of E, you can write it as gradient of E times U in the domain minus plus bounding. And this is a very general phenomenon. When you have a representation of a distribution, you can make a lot of change. It doesn't change the distribution in the sense that functional is still the same, but which has not the same representation, meaning the same terms everywhere. So, if you have, for instance, a term which is x times the gradient of u plus y times u. If the divergence of x plus y is zero everywhere, and if the two tensors x and y have compact support in the domain, then you can add this term to any distribution, which will not change because this distribution is zero. Okay? So mind that this is true if x and y are smooth enough. X is a measure and cannot compute easily its divergence, then we have problems. But if the tensors are smooth enough, then you can integrate by part using the divergence theorem and you can change the terms. So typically, for expansion strength, he was starting with one order distribution and writing it as a sum of two zero-order distributions. So different representations. So this point, so we discussed it yesterday when we were dinner, at this point is making things intricate, but this point is fundamental to understand the Cauchy and D'Alembert point of view, because it is only a question of writing the same distribution in different ways. How I will show. So the idea is that the distribution which is defined on the domain omega inside the open set, if everything is regular enough, then you can integrate by part and you can get rid of all derivatives inside the domain. So that's the case for the first example here. But if you have second derivative of u, third derivative of u, you can integrate by part one, twice, third, and then get rid of all the derivatives. So that's, let's say, that's more or less easy in the body, in the volume. You integrate by part and you send everything on the boundary, and you keep only a body force inside the matter. If you are on the boundary and you want to integrate by part again, so Francisco showed you that it was difficult, and our teaching is the art of saying this, repeating and repeating, I will do it again. You start with a distribution.
Prove you are correct.
Thank you. So you have a distribution on the boundary, on the surface, more generally on the manifold. This distribution involves different derivatives of u. Some are transverse to the manifold. If you are on the surface, you have the normal derivative of the displacement, but you have also tangential derivative of the displacement. So if you want to integrate by part on the boundary, you can only do that with the tangential derivative. So for the normal derivative, you can do nothing. So you have to divide in the distribution, what part involves the transverse derivative and which part involves the tangent derivative. So the representation theorem of Schwarz says that if you have a distribution, you can write it as a sum, a finite sum, of something which acts on the transverse derivative. So this is a bit misleading, because here the function fk are not functions. There are still distributions which are working on the tangential derivative. Here, we have put apart the transverse derivative of u, but fk still contains the tangential derivative. So this means that here, you are integrating some tangential derivative of this. Okay? So, it is a way of dividing the derivative which appears in the formula in transverse derivatives and tangential derivatives.
Why do you say tangent derivative if you write orthogonal?
So, here I mean, so, let me be clear. In a square, on the boundary of the square, okay, I'm here. And I have something which looks like the integral of C, D, U, which one? D. No matter the component. Over D is 1, D is 2. Here, this one. And this is an integral over this line, S. Here. So I divide the derivative as C,
what is X1, what is X2?
So, X1, X2. And I am along this line. So, first derivative say nothing more than you can divide this as C, D over D, X1, over D, over D. That's nothing more. So, you are that, which is a distribution F, applied to du over dx. Okay? So, my first formula here means nothing more than you can write the distribution, any distribution, as a distribution which is an intrinsic distribution of the manifold involving only tangent derivatives applied to transverse derivatives. Okay? So nothing, and okay, just a way of writing this. Questions?
You are invoking the two Schwarz, two different Schwarz, the French one and the German one. because you're getting the figure, but you can interchange your total Schwarz. It's not the same.
Hermann
Schwarz or Laurent Schwarz. Because you can also permit the derivative, it's one, it's two, and left.
Yeah. Yes, of course, I have to permit it.
So we need two on the Schwarz here.
Okay, let's say Schwarzes.
So it's. Yes, of course, it is implicit that it is.
No.
So, the integration by part will only involve this part of the this one, you cannot do anything. So now, if you assume that this here is smooth enough, that is, that the tangent distribution is smooth, then you can integrate by parts of the suspect function. And this will remain like this. Okay? So this is what I will assume. I will assume that the fk, which are distributions, are smooth enough to be integrated by parts of the manifold. So if you do that, then at the end, every derivative of spectrum one will disappear. And it will only remain here a function. Okay? So you will have the same formula in which fk now are functions and not distribution. But the price to pay for that is that you integrate by part, so you have boundary terms. So if your manifold has boundary, if you are on a sphere, it's finished. But if you have some edge, some boundary form, for the surface, then you will get terms along the boundary of the manifold. If you are on the face, you will get terms along the edges, and if you are on the edge, you will get terms at the wedges.
Of course, the F and the second formula is different.
Yeah. The same form, but totally changing them. Okay. So, now I want to explain what is the difference between Cauchy approach and D'Alembert approach. So in both cases, the idea is to describe the interactions, mechanical interactions, which are applied on a subbody D, on part of the domain, part of the body, so a subbody D, by the outside of the subbody. The outside of the subbody is a complementary. And you want to describe what are these mechanical interactions. So, in the general setting, these interactions are distributions. So, yeah, there is two points of view. The point of view of Cauchy is to say, okay, these are forces applied on the boundary of the domain. So, in a more general setting, it is a particular distribution applied on the boundary of the domain. So, you write as sigma for like a frontier of the domain, as a distribution concentrated along the boundary, the projective boundary of the domain, of the subbody. So it is a sum of terms with measures TF which are concentrated on the boundary. So In the original setting of Cauchy, this is nothing else than the integral on the boundary of D of F times U. So power of external forces in the Cauchy sense. Well, I want to introduce more general forces, so instead of F U, I agree that you can have some G, gradient, and so on. But anyway, this is something which is integrated on the boundary. By integrated on the boundary, I mean that the measures are something which are on the boundary. Boundary in the large sense, boundary is faces, but also edges, wedges, anything which lies on the topological boundary of the symbol. Okay, the point of view of Dalembert is different. It's to say the mechanical interactions have distribution inside the volume. So he doesn't say exactly that. What did he say? He say the power of internal forces is distributed inside the body. But just after that, he said, okay, but the power of internal forces is opposite to the power of external forces. So he's writing that the power of external forces is a distribution concentrated inside the body. Okay? So I want to forget anything about the theorem of virtual power. So Dalembert said the virtual power of internal forces is something like that. The integral of the domain of, let's say, two times the gradient in the first gradient setting. Then you wrote P and minus x plus p and equal to 0. So I'm not interested in such theorem principle. What I want just to say is that doing these two things, Dalembert said that px has this form. Okay? So that's it. So it's exactly the same form, but the assumption is that 2 now is inside the open set, instead of being on the boundary. So the two points of view is to write the same thing, we know that it is the same thing, as a function defined in the body or defined on the boundary. Okay. So to reconcile the two points of view is to remember that we have said that there is no uniqueness in the way of writing a distribution, so we can hope that both points of view are compatible. We can take the first one and write it in as the second one, or conversely. So now the work is to take one of these forms, write it under the second form, and conversely. So the Dalembert procedure to make the theory is to start from the second form of contact distribution and to write it in the first form. And Cauchy start with the first form and write it in the second. That's the true work to do. In fact, we have to prove the equivalence of the two settings. For that, we need some assumption, we need some theorem. The two ways are not the same. One way is easier to do than the other one, but the work is good. So the idea starting from this is just to integrate by part. This is not too difficult to do. In the first gradient setting, it's very easy. You start with this, you integrate by part. You need some smoothness, some regularity assumption. Otherwise, you cannot do the job. You write it as the integral of t minus times v plus the integral of the boundary of t times the normal v. So, I was not completely precise. Here, it is up to a body force. When I say the two are equivalent, in fact, I am not so sufficiently precise because here I am making a confusion between the power of external force and the power of contact force. The difference is the body force. So meaning that when we want to prove that the two expressions are the same, it is up to a body force term. So here, up to this body force term, I have transform this expression in this expression. So this is the Dalembert type description of mechanical interaction, and that's it. This is the Cauchy type description of contact calculation. So I just give a name to this, call this F, and that's it. Okay? The other way, you know it, because it's something which is the basic of continuum mechanics, it's the theorem of Cauchy using the famous defined argument. You start with this, F on the boundary, and you try to write it in this way, and you know that takes more work to do. You have to construct the stress tensor starting from the force on the boundary. It's not just an integration by part, you have to construct the stress tensor starting from forces. Okay? So that's what I will show in the end gradient setting. I'm trying to show you how to pass from one expression to the other one. Surface tension inside the domain, you cannot do it if you assume that the stress or hyperstress inside the domain is a volume density. So, for instance, if you want to model a foam in which you have many interfaces and deal with the surface tension, then you are out of this theory. So, here, we don't do the theory for everything, there is a strong assumption which looks like technical because we just have some derivability, but in fact it is physical assumptions which are hidden behind this technicalities. So there are other technical assumptions. For instance, you assume that a priori everything depends on the considerate symbol. So the number of derivative depends on D. The fields depend on D. So we assume that we have a number of derivatives which is bounded for all possible subdomains. So why not having the order of the distribution which increase when you consider smaller and smaller balls? Why not? It is forbidden because it's easier to do only. So maybe from the physical point of view, there are things interesting by considering the possibility of the order of the distribution to tend to infinity for some family of domains. Why? We assume that the fields tau s do not depend on the domain. So this is a bit strange because we are considering the interaction, the mechanical interaction over the subbody T. Of course, it depends on D. So here, in the D'Alembert setting, you assume that the tensor tau s do not depend on D. This is a locality assumption. Why? Because you assume that it depends on D only through its local shape. Something you can look at locally. And when you are inside an open set, the only thing that you can see is that you are inside the body. If you don't see far, you don't see the boundary of your domain, you are inside the domain, you don't know what is the type of the domain, what is the shape of your domain. So if you assume that it depends on the domain through the shape locally, then it doesn't depend on the domain. So now I have to open parentheses and say something about what is the shape. What do we call a shape? So to be precise, you have two domains, two third bodies, D and D prime, two points, X and X prime, and you want to express the fact that the shape of D at point X is the same as the shape of D prime at point X prime. And the idea is very simple. You make a translation from X to X prime, and you ask that locally it's identical. You have a neighborhood O of X, O prime from X prime, and you translate the intersection between O and D, and you will have to find O prime, D prime. So this is a very simple notion. You have a point here, a domain D, X. You have another point X prime, another domain D prime. And you say, okay, the shape of D at this point is the same as the shape of D prime at this point. If you can find an open set O around X, and another one here, O prime, and, then you make the translation here, and this is exactly the same as this. So, on my drawing, it's false, because this is here, and this is prime. So this is not simply this part translated. So the notion of shape means that everything is the same locally, but the position. It just translated.
No orientation.
No orientation. Meaning that if you are here, and if you are here, X is prime. Then the shape here is not the same as the shape. The shape contains the notion of orientation. It contains everything locally but the position. Okay? So it is clearly an equivalence relationship, and you give a name to a class with respect to this relationship because that's a shape. Okay? But now, if you are inside the domain, let's say I point Y here, inside the open set. And you are here inside the domain. Then clearly the shape is the same. Why? You take a small ball here. The ball is the same radius here. You make the translation, it's clearly the same. Indeed, the point Y sees the shape of T by looking only in the vicinity of itself. So it doesn't see anything. It's just that it is inside the body. Okay? So, by asking that the stress or hyperstress tensor Torres do depend on the only of the shape locally, it's exactly that saying that it doesn't depend on the domain. Okay, so now when you have this assumption, I need that. So just notation. What is a domain and how you do the integration by parts of the domain? So you need to make some assumption about the regularity of the subbodies you are considering. So they are made by phases, so a conscious call already described. You have regular part of the boundary, which are called faces, which concur on lines, which are called edges, and the edges concur at points, which are called wedges.
So regarding your definition of shape,
yes.
The points of the ensemble, they are material points or geometrical points? So your material point and the extent that you perform it?
Yes. A subbody is a subset of the.
So it's spatial. You are not considering the material point. Yeah. Collision. It's a purely spatial.
So the boundary is divided in three parts. The parts which are regular, so the intersection of the faces, which is denoted partial 2 of D. The 2 is with respect to the dimension the faces are of dimension 2. And now the union of the edges is D1, 2 of D, and the wedges which are only points dimension 0 is denoted D of D. So now you need to have some notation. Nk means the external normal to the faces. And on the lines, you have two faces which concur. You have the normal of the two faces. And you have also the tangent to the line, which is denoted E, with a subscript on the edge. And you have also two normals which are tangent to the faces and orthogonal to the line at this point. Okay, I still need to notation to say, okay, if I am on an edge which is called L1, for instance, then I have two faces which occur there. These two faces are two indices, and this indices is denoted by HI with brackets. This is the subgrid of the faces which concur on this line. And the set for the wedges, X is bracket, means the subscript of all edges which concur at this wedge. So, maybe the only example of domain I will consider here is a tetrahedron, which is the typical example of such domain with four faces. F1, F2, F3, I'm beginning at 0 here, the MFCs. And you have six edges. I haven't given any name for the edges here along this space. I will focus on these three edges here, E1 for the line L1, E2 here for the edge L2. And so the height of the tetrahedron is here with respect to N naught. Okay, so this is a case where the faces are flat, but it need not be flat. It can be any image of the tetrahedron with respect to some different orbital. We can now deform the tetrahedron. No, not the ball. Depends on the regular performance. I will ask to be sufficiently regular so an edge will also remain an edge. Because you cannot deform a ball to a tetrahedron.
It's only one edge.
Yes, only. I ask some more regularity. Okay, so what's the procedure for starting from D'Alembert expression and ending with the Cauchy-type expression? You take all terms in the stress state. You integrate them by part until you have only body force inside the domain. Okay. All other terms are sent to the boundary, to the smooth part of the boundary, to the faces. Okay. Then you want to do it again on the faces. And then you have to divide what is transverse, derivative, and tangent derivatives. And so here is a difficulty. So the purely transverse terms, you have no problem. You cannot do anything. But you have terms in which you have transverse and tangent derivatives. And you have to reorganize this in order to have the tangent derivative on the, let's say, right-hand side of your system, left-hand side of your system, in order to apply to divergent theory. And this is this reorganization, which needs some wavy notation, which Francesco showed me yesterday and will show you again. And then, once reorganized, you can again integrate by part on the faces until you have only until you have no more derivative with respect to the tangent space. You have only transverse derivatives. And then you send some terms along the edges, and you go on along the edges up to the wedge. And as Francesco said, on the wedges, everything is transverse, so you have nothing to do. You stop there. Unless you work in, you prefer to work in a fourth dimensional space or in, okay, so the notation which are needed here is the notation for the reorganization of the derivatives if you want to integrate by parts. So Francesco already showed you this formula, which is integration by part formula. So you want to integrate a term like that on the manifold. You say, okay, in these terms, I have purely transverse terms. So this, I can't do anything about that. I can do that. Yeah. But the other one, I can integrate by part. But to integrate by part, it is not, simply the difference between T and the orthogonal part of T. You have to organize in order to have the derivative on the right side of the system. And it cannot work easily. Why? Because T is a completely symmetric tensor, this one too. So when you make the difference, you have a completely symmetric tensor which contains a tangent derivative. So you have no hope that the tangent derivative will be on the right side of the tensor, because it is completely symmetric. So you have to reorganize it, and the reorganization is described. So you introduce first a projection in which you say, okay, PQ, so M is with respect to the considered manifold, you can forget it. P is with respect to the order of the tensor you are applying your projector, you can forget it. So in the first one, you have P indexed by Q, meaning that you take the transverse part for the first Q element of the tensor, and the tangent part for the last P minus Q element. Okay? So you take a tensor order P divided in X tensor product is Y, X is of order Q, Y is of order P minus Q, and take the orthogonal part for X and the tangent part for Y. This is not complicated. And then the reorganization of the tensor T, which has no purely transverse component, is the following. You apply PQ to T times some vector, some generic vector V, the parallel part of the vector V. You sum up from Q equal to 0 to minus 1. You multiply by the binomial coefficients, you get something, and at the end you take the totally symmetric part of this. So this is a long and intricate way of reorganizing a tensor in such a way that it is completely symmetric in the first indices, and the last one is tangent. When you do this reorganization, then you can use the divergence theorem. Some divergence here of the reorganized part of T and the reorganized part of T times the external normal to the manifold you are considering. Okay? And you cannot write this in an easier way because this reorganization is needed to apply the divergence theorem. Okay, so the theorem is the following. You start with the D'Alembert expression. It can be written in the Cauchy form, where all the forces, the S forces, meaning forces, double force, and so on, can be written in terms of the sequence of tensors, hyperstress tensors, which appears in the D'Alembert expression. So it is explicit but complex. So Francesco showed you the whole set of equations which relates F to the hyperstress. I only write here the highest order terms. So the highest order forces on the faces are simply the highest order hyperstress tensor times the normal and takes the transverse part to the face. That's for surface forces. So the notation are the following. The index 2 means we are here on the faces which are object of dimension 2. This is for edges, which are object of dimension 1, and this is for wedge, which are object of dimension 2. So 2, 1, 0 is related to the object on which the force are applied. And this index here is the order of the distribution which is applied on this object. So this is an n minus 1 force, n minus 2, n minus 3. These are the highest order terms.
No, there's two next one.
Because this is the dimension of the object on which you apply the force. So, surface, line, points, and then.
Okay. Yeah, okay, but you say you write only from the highest order.
Ah, okay.
So it means you have something to write from the lower order.
Yes, so then you can decrease this index.
So you have an F2
minus 2, n minus 2.
Yeah,
okay.
F1
and minus 3. Yeah, it is a complex expression. Okay, functional showed me yesterday with the sum and some divergence and so on. Okay? I put here only the highest order term because it is on these terms I will focus for making the converse computation. Okay, now I skip to the Cauchy-Mort approach. So, before generalizing the original Cauchy's approach, I want to show you what are the assumptions which are behind the Cauchy theory. So, it's a long story, but the assumption was clearly written in the original paper of Cauchy. So, he wrote things like that. A small element experiences on its different faces and at each point of them a determined pressure or tension, which can depend on the orientation of the surface. So, and if we go on, nice saying, this being said. So clearly it was written, this is my assumption, and I will make the theory based on this assumption. This assumption is well known, it is a Cauchy postulate. But there is two things in this assumption. First, it is something which is on the faces, on the regular part of the boundary. Here he was saying no edge forces by faces. And he has also that contact and interaction depend only on the normal of the boundary. Okay? So two assumptions denoted H1, H. Then he wrote, the equilibrium should hold between inertial force and the forces to which reduces all pressures and tension exerted on the surfaces. So he was then accepting the third assumption that contact interactions are balanced by some volume forces. Okay? And it is a very important ingredient in the demonstration. Construction of surfaces. Then in the proof, he applies the balance of forces to domains where we were smaller and smaller, and he said a very small volume so that every dimension is an infinitesimal quantity of first order, the mass being an infinitesimal quantity of the third order, and finally he stated that pressure and tension on a small face experienced by moving from one point to another one on the face and infinitesimal variation of the first order. That, in modern language, means that it was assuming the continuity of contact interaction with space deposition. So it was a regularity assumption. Okay, then he was built the theory on these four assumptions. And then later, Noel proved that the dependence with respect to the normal is a consequence of another type of assumption, which is that there exists a uniform bound for surface contact interaction, which is valid for all possible subbodies. So it is not written exactly like that, but it is implicit, and it is used in the group of non-theory. So he replaced the Cauchy postulate, which is physical, which is the contact interaction depends only on the orientation of the surface, by something which looks rather technical, just a uniform bound for all subbodies, an assumption which you accept easily by saying, oh, it's just a mathematical assumption, no importance for this assumption. And indeed, this assumption, as well as Cauchy postulate, rules out all possibility of introducing higher gradient theories. The uniform bound means that if you take smaller and smaller balls, a linear dependence upon the curvature of the boundary is forbidden, because the curvature increases, so the interaction will increase, and you have no bound. If you take smaller and smaller balls, then you will get higher and higher interactions. So the assumption of norm forbids that, and doing this, it forbids second bending theory. So it is not purely a mathematical assumption. It is really a physical assumption, which is completely equivalent to Cauchy postulate. So by doing this, he hides the physical meaning of Cauchy postulate behind something which looks like a technical assumption. So what we have to do if we want to make the theory for higher gradient models is to get rid of assumption H1. H1 is the fact that you have only forces on the regular part of the boundary. So if you get rid of H1, then H2 has no sense. Because if you are not on the regular part, you have not the normal, you cannot have the force to depend only on the normal. And you have to get rid also on the assumption.
Can you give some idea of the demonstration of flow? Just to the
quite easy. Take a surface. Take a small plate, and here a plate, a flat. So the intersection of a small cylinder with the domain. The domain is here. This is of order epsilon square. This is of order epsilon. The volume is very small. You let everything shrink to zero, and you compute the order of magnitude of the different factors. You have forces on the lateral boundary, which is very small because this is a order epsilon square. So at the end, it remains only the force on the upper surface and the force on the lower surface. They have to be balanced. And this tells you that the force on the curved surface is the same as the force on the flat surface. Okay? But here, the assumption that the lateral force are bounded is very important, because you estimate this force by simply multiplying the order of magnitude of the force by the lateral surface area. This is wrong in second bending theory. Moreover, you are neglecting the possibility of having forces along the edges, which is important. Okay, so we start with four contact action, which is, by assumption, made of Skripal. A part on the regular, on the faces, plus a part on the edges, plus a part on the wedges. So they are distribution with respect to transverse derivatives, and the fields Fk are assumed to be smooth enough to be integrated by bar along the manifolds on which they are defined. So they are called k, k plus 1 forces, and we assume that they depend on the position in a regular way. And by regular, I mean c, the right number. Okay? Now, of course, this force depends on the shape of T. That we know that because even in the Cauchy theorem, the force depends on the orientation of the surface. So, they depend on the shape of the dot. This is a real problem, and this is the interesting point in this theory. How the force depends on the shapes. So, we have to get rid of null assumption because it is too strong and it kills every possibility of having higher gravity. But we need something anyway. So we ask that these forces are bounded, but not for all subbodies, but for, let's say, a finite set of bodies. If you have a finite set of bodies, then your forces are bounded. So it's a bit more general than the finite set of bodies. Something we have called prescribed shapes. So you have a finite set of bodies plus the possibility of cutting this plane as you want. It's a finite number of planes and things like that. But this is a technical assumption, and I remind you that behind technical assumptions are always some physical assumptions. So there is some boundedness in this set. And then the tool which replaced what Cauchy wrote about the balance of force by inertial force, here is replaced by the fact that the power of forces has to be balanced by something, which is, let's say, the power of inertial force, but more generally is bounded by something which is smaller than the volume of D. That means the power of the contact forces is balanced by, we have in mind the power of internal forces, but anyway, something which is bounded by the volume of the domain. Of course, it depends on U, constant depends on U. But for each U, so the power which is expanded on the boundary is comparable to the volume of the domain. Okay? So these are the assumptions. And now, what are the questions? I've been asked some questions. First, we are dealing with distributions. Okay, but forces are still there. So why cannot we still use the Cauchy theory for forces and forgetting everything about things which are not forces? So the question is, the forces, meaning the zero order distribution, are they still balanced? And the answer is yes, they are. Meaning that even if you have double force, triple force, couples, the forces applied to the system are still balanced. So in this sense, we could still use Cauchy theorem, because this ingredient is still valid. So why not apply Cauchy theorem? And indeed, if you look at the equilibrium equation in second gradient theory, there appears a tensor which has exactly the same effect in the equilibrium equation, the volume one, as the classical Cauchy theorem. So you can ask yourself, is that not the Cauchy theory? Is the Cauchy theory not valid in this system? So the answer is no. No, because every fundamental assumption which is at the base of Cauchy theory is no more valid. The first one is to say it is not true anymore than the force along the surface depend only on the inner nature. Then you can say, okay, but Cauchy made this theory by using a tetrahedron. In a tetrahedron, all the faces are flat. So what is the effect of curvature there? There is no curvature, so you can apply the Cauchy theory. But there is still an error, because in Cauchy theory, there is no force along edges. And in the second balance theory and higher balance theory, there are forces along edges. So it is still wrong to use Cauchy theory. Okay, so if you are convinced that there are edge forces, there are wave forces, that forces are balanced, you can say, okay, let's try to make the Cauchy theory just considering forces, but taking into account the fact that you have edge forces and wedge forces. Okay, so let's try. You try, I don't. Because Nolan Degas already tried to do that in 19, they failed. Meaning that they didn't obtain a representation of these forces. They have to make more or less the assumption of the result. And the point is that if you want to obtain the representation of the result, you have to use the quasi-balance inequality. This last inequality, I call the quasi-balance inequality. You have to use this inequality not only for constant field u. If you use this for constant field u, it is a balance of force. And if you use this inequality only with constant field u, then you have not enough tools to build your representation theory. So the fact that you have taken into account higher distribution is the fact that you have to use this inequality with fields which are not constant. And in fact, the double force or triple force are closely related to the existence of edge forces and wedge forces, and you cannot try to represent a part of them without representing the other part. So, how to make something which is a copy of Cauchy construction for higher gradient systems. So I will describe that now. You start with the Cauchy type distribution. So you have forces, S forces, along faces, along edge, and along wedge. And you have an inequality which says that this is bounded by some constant times the volume of the domain you are considering. And as Cauchy did, you apply that to small, a family of small tetrahedrons. Okay? So, you apply that to small tetrahedrons and you choose the field u as a polynomial function of degree n minus 1 times some generic vector u. So, two remarks. As Francesco said yesterday, the vector nature of u naught is not relevant. You can consider u naught as a vector if you want, because you have in mind the displacement. It can be a tensor, but it's not relevant. And it's much easier in the computation to consider it as a scalar. If it's not a scalar, you do the computation component by component. Okay, so u now is a scalar function. Moreover, now, moreover, you see that the bounds for the solid here are different. You can have y, but n minus 1 here, n minus 2, n minus 3. Just because it's easier to make the computation, if it's not these bounds which are here, you can always add some zero forces in order to write this in this way. You can increase the bounds in order to have the bounds in this way. Because in fact, at the end, it is this setting which will be the right one. And now you say, okay, I take small tetrahedrons, so this tends to zero, like epsilon at the power of 3. So if I divide all this by epsilon at the power of 2, then it tends to zero. If you divide this expression by the size at one of the phases of the delta harmonic, and it has to tend to zero. So the idea is to estimate all terms in these sums to say that many are tending to zero, and having a look on the highest order terms in this limit. So you have many things which disappear because the test function which is chosen here vanishes on the plane. So the tetrahedron here is a tetrahedron. It is a family of tetrahedron made like that. You have the point x bar where you want to estimate the stress tensor, like the stress tensor. And you have fixed a family the orientation of the faces, N1, N2, N3, N0, as you want. And you make your tetrahedron in such a way that this is your face F0, and then this is that's it, and the head here will go to the edge. So you shrink the family of tetrahedron with respect to one point here. So the chosen test field is such that it vanishes on this face, and all its derivative up to n minus 2 vanish on this space. So almost everything will vanish on this space, and it will remain only terms on the other faces. Okay? So many terms disappear due to this fact, and it is also why I have not given name to these edges or to these wedges, because everything disappears. Then you estimate the order of magnitude of the different terms. The function here is x minus x bar in the n-log direction at the power n minus 1. This quantity here is something which belongs to the interval 0, epsilon. Epsilon dimension. Because I have not precise, but let's say this is epsilon. The end of the time. So this is about the epsilon. Right. O epsilon. So this is about the epsilon at the power n minus 1. So very small. I divided by epsilon at the power 2. So almost all terms will tend to 0 here. So this is true also for derivatives, but in derivatives, then the power decreases and the order of magnitude decreases. So at the end, you estimate the order of magnitude of all derivatives integrated over phase, over lines, or at points. So you have the order of magnitude of the derivatives, the value of the derivative, but you have also the order of magnitude of the area, of the length, and for point loss. So in the first estimation here, you have the area of the face you are considering times the order of magnitude of the derivative. You get the order of magnitude of the term. And doing this, you end with this expression. You have a limit in which you have only three terms along faces, the highest order terms along faces, and F0 has disappeared. No, F0 has not disappeared. It's a sum point 0 to 3, so you have the four faces of the tetrahedron. You have an integration over the three lines L1, L2, and L3, meaning these ones. The other disappear, and you have only one wedge, which is this one. This the other has disappeared. So these are the terms which will have a finite limit when you pass to the end.
I always wonder what you mean by the edge. The English word edge stands for a volumetric body, prismatic, where one edge has a very sharp angle. Do you mean vertices?
Vertices is better?
Much better. You mean the corner point?
I'm not right. It's a word, so I will accept your modification. So let's say vertices.
There is a tradition. This is the problem. We use wedge because it has been already used in this context. So they call edges and wedges, and we are simply following
this. In which context?
But anyway, we mean
description of polyhedral sizing.
It's a question of things, but the points where the sides of the diagram are concurring, this is what
the edges are bodies, are not points. Yeah. It's a vertex. Yeah.
Okay.
So now we pass to the limit which is system. So you take the mean value theorem and replace the integration by the value of the forces in some points inside the face, the lines, and so on. You can do that away to your continuity assumption. And then you estimate the area of the faces, the length of the lines, precisely, and you obtain this expression. Not very easy to deal with, but this is due to the fact that it is much better to work with a generic tetrahedron than an orthogonal tetrahedron. So the computation of the area of the different faces is more complicated, but and this is the reason why you have these terms here. This is the determinant of N1, N2, and N3. And in this expression, now it's easy to pass to the limit. Why? Because epsilons appears only in the voids here, which are somewhere inside the element, inside the face of the light. So when you pass to the limit, you will just, by continuity, find the value of the force at 0 point x bar. So passing to the limit is just replacing. Okay, now we have an identity. And this identity allows you to find the value of this term in terms of all other terms. Okay. So now you are organized to see that everything is, in every term, you have n naught at the power n minus 1. Here it's clear, here it's clear, but here you have n not here, but you have n not there, and then.
V2, dot and dot.
N minus 1, n at the power, n. So you organize in this way. Question of organizing the answers. And now you say, okay, I will give a name of these three objects here, of the sum of these three objects, and call that a tensor CN. So you get this expression, where tilde CN is just the sum of all these terms. And that's it. You have an expression in which you can express the n minus 1, the n force on the face F0 in terms of other. And that is something in which there is no n naught. So you have something which is a representation theorem in the sense that you have the force on the face F0 in terms of objects in which you don't have n naught. So it's not completely unique because you are still to get rid of the scalar product, but this is not difficult. Why? Because you know that this object is a purely transverse object. So it is a scalar times Edmer as a polar. So you can rewrite this in this way. You get the theorem that the surface force of the highest order is given by some tensor applied to Edmer at a power n, and this is scalar multiplied by Edmer at the power n minus.
In the previous expression, in the previous slide, you have the n1, n2, n3, which are related to Edmund.
No, they are not related. N1, n2, and n3 are the normal to these three phases. You can now choose, and it is a Cauchy argument, you can choose the orientation of the fourth phase and dependently from the orientation of the three first phases. Okay? You can modify n0 without modifying n1, n2, and n3.
So E1
is this direction. So it is related to N1, N2, and N3, but it is not related to N0. Okay. So everything here is a function of N1, N2, and N3, but not N1. Okay? And capital E was here. So through a circular permutation, E1 tensor E2 is denoted capital E3, and so on. Okay? Just to make the formula a bit more compact. Okay? But the theorem says something more. It says there exists a unique, completely symmetric tensor, Cn, such that the formula is valid. And what we have done is not that. First, the tensor is not symmetric, and then the uniqueness is not sure at all. So to prove the result now, you have to check that you can replace the Cn we have defined by its completely symmetric tensor. But this is quite trivial. Why? Because here, you are making the scalar product of Cn by a completely symmetric tensor. So if you replace it by the completely symmetric, it doesn't change. It won't change anything in your form. This is heavy. And now you have to prove the uniqueness. And this is a purely topological lemma. If you have a function which is a function of the normal at the power of p in the sphere. And if on some open subset it coincides with another function of the same type, then it is the same function. So uniqueness is just a purely mathematical concept, no physics. Now, it is a representation formula, but it is not valid for all n0. Because I said, okay, you can choose n0 independently on n1, n2, and n3. It is not completely true, because you can choose n0, but not in the whole sphere. You are limited. You are limited by a triangle. Okay? Here, n0 should have a negative scalar product with n1, n2, and n3. So you are limited in the sphere to some triangle in the sphere. So you have to extend the result for all n0 in the sphere. And this is a problem that Cauchy already encountered, and he solved that by applying the action-reaction principle and using this principle to come to the whole sphere. But we realized that indeed it is not necessary to introduce a new mechanical ingredient here. It is a purely mathematical fact. And this is the following lemma. If you have a function on the sphere, which has the form Cn scalar n at the power of p, this tensor depending on the open set you are considering. So on each open set, at each point, there is an open set around the point, on which the function takes this form, then there is a unique C for which it is valid on towards there. And all the representation coincide with C. And this is true only if you consider completely symmetric transforms. This is why it is very important to use the completely symmetric part of CN and not the CN you are defining at the beginning.
So this is a, you should place it the lemma of imparity.
Yes.
But in the proof of the lemma of imparity, you use the Cauchy uses the balance of the forces. So here you don't need your assumption of equality.
The point is, why you have made a construction with a defining, it's enough. You can conclude using only this lemma, which is purely topological. This is just related to the fact that the sphere is connected. And that more or less you say, okay, I have for in the Cauchy setting, it's a linear function you are looking at. You have something which is linear on all open sets at the vicinity of all points in the sphere. It is a linear function on the whole sphere. And it is easy linear. So now, how many times? The CN, so we got what we got here is a real, is an actual representation theorem, because we have a tensor CN, which now, so I have to insist on the fact that CN, we construct it by using N1, N2, N3. So CL, at the beginning, depends on the choice we make for these three vectors. It depends on, let me show you it again. CF is a completely symmetric part of this object. So you see, in this object, we have N1, N2, N3 everywhere. Here, but also this vector, and also in the fact that here you are considering force relative to a phase with normal energy. See, here you are considering forces as forces on a line which has as geometry a tangent vector which is hi, but also two normals which is related, which are related to N1 and 2. So this is a very tricky object which is completely linked to the geometry of the network we have shown at the beginning. But now, let's close the lemma. Here, it is said that the tensor C is valid for all open subsets, meaning for all trigonometry you have chosen. You change the tetragon, you change the function CL. In order, you may change it. But the lemma says, no, in fact, you are not. So this proves that, indeed, the CL you have built does not depend at the end of N1 in 2 minutes.
What in the corresponding argument in classical coefficient case?
It's the same. Using the action reaction principle, it is said that the stress tensor is valid for the whole sphere. And then you say, okay, the axis I have chosen at the beginning can be, I can do it again with another, but it's the same axis. Wait. That's a long time I made it for students. How to prove that your construction of stress tensor in Cauchy theory is not dependent on the axis you could choose. No, I'm not sure. So, now, what about edge forces and vertices forces? So, the same tensor is able to represent edge and vertices forces. And And the way is not so simple as we can expect, because we have already made the D'Alembert approach, so we know that the formula are not so simple. They are almost the same, they look like the same. And you have the following thing, that the edge force is related to Cn through some projector, through the geometric vectors which represent the geometry of the edge. And you have, so this is the sum for all faces which border the edge. And then you take the symmetric part at the end, and also you take the transverse part of the system. So what is the projector tensor now? It's not the same than in D'Alembert projector. So more or less, it looks like that it's not the same. You have the tensor, which is written as a product of a Q tensor, a vector, and a Q minus 2 minus 1 tensor. So X, V, 1. You don't change anything for X. You take the orthogonal part from Y, the tangent part from V, but you put V on the right side of the constant. So it is, it's not a projection. Projection plus the composition. Okay, and now you solve up all these objects applied to the tensor from Q equal to 1. From 1 to 2. This makes type of projector, and this is what is used in this formula. So, why this object? And how do you compute this expression? So it is easy. Why? Because it is easy, not so easy. We have an expression for Cn. It is the total symmetric part of Cn tilde, where Cn tilde is given by this formula. Okay? So in order to prove this theorem, you just have to take your expression for Cn and check that this is an identity. Okay? So, first, you do it with Cn tilde. Because Cn tilde is a sum, and you will compute the term for all addends in Cn tilde. So, you check that all addends vanish. The only remaining term is the one which involves quantity 1, which is F1 and minus 1. Then you have to check also that the remaining term gives the right identity. And it is at this point that you have to introduce these ugly operators. Because when you make the computation, you find the result, and you find the complicated expression it relates to objects, and you compact your formula. Okay, so just a computation. You have everything, you have just to compute and cancel what is cancelled. Okay, but that's true for CNT. Now you have to replace it by its computing symmetric. And this is a rather comparison computation to prove that you don't change the formula by replacing this object by its totally symmetric. You are working by duality and making some. Alors, it's difficult because it is not. This replacement can be done addend by addend. And for some addends, it's clear that by making a permutation, you don't change anything. But for some addends, you don't succeed. You make a permutation, and it's changed. And in fact, you have to remember that here you have a sum for all k which concur on the line. And each addend by itself is not invariant by permutation, but the sum of two addends are. So that's the point. Okay. Now, when you get the formula with tilde Cn, it is not at all a presentation formula. Why? Because in the expression of C and tilde, you have F1, F1. You have this object. So you are representing this object with a tensor which contains the object. This is not a representation formula. You can do it in a simpler way, just by writing F1 equal to F1. Okay? So,
Only the L1,
but as the data is generated, this can be applied to any edge. Yeah. Because you can use the tetrahedron which is adapted to the line you are considering. So this is not the problem. The problem is that you are writing F1 in terms of a tensor which contains F1. So this is C. It is only when you have replaced CNT by CN that you got actual representation formula. Because CN doesn't depend on anything. CN is representative of the stress state of the material. There is no geometry inside CN. Okay, the same for the vertices, but it's much more complicated because the formula is here. So you have compute all terms in this sum with CN2. Prove that you have only the right term at CN. And then you have to prove that you can replace CN by CN. And it is much more complicated because for some terms you have to use the fact that you are summing over the faces. And for some terms you have also to use the fact that you are summing for all edges coming at the vertices. Okay, so once you have put this representation formula, it happens that you can subtract to your initial distribution the distribution made by Cn times n gradient d plus delta from Cn and n minus 1 derivative of 2. And you get a new stress state in the sense of Cauchy, but of order n minus 1. And moreover, it is still quasi-balanced. This means that you can apply to this new object what you have done at the order n. So you can use an induction argument to say, OK, now, in this one, I do the same. I have a representation for the highest order term of this new object. So you get a new tensor, Cn minus 1, for representing that object. But unfortunately, the highest order term of this object are not exactly the lower terms of the original object. There is a transformation which makes formulas very ugly to write. But anyway, in this procedure, you get a chain of tensors, Cn, Cn minus 1, up to C, down to C1, which transform your initial Cauchy type expression in a D'Alembert type expression, in which these objects are not directly the Cn object, but are related to the CN hyperstress by these formulas. So this is done. You start with the Cauchy type of expression, and you end up with the D'Alembert type expression. So the relationship between the hyperstress and the S-force in the boundary has been made in both procedures, from D'Alembert to Cauchy, from Cauchy to D'Alembert. But unfortunately for us, the expression was not exactly the same, because here we have, these projectors, these operators, while in the D'Alembert procedures we had this one. And they are not the same. You see here you have some binomial coefficients, there is no binomial coefficients in Cauchy proportion. So people which read attentively out of this process, it's not the same problem. Okay, so I said the circle is almost closed, but the formulas are slightly different. So there is a theorem, it's rather technical, saying that anyway the formula are the same, even if the operator is not equivalent, the formula will be the same. So it is no interest, it's just a question of a lot of computation about transfer to put that in the result of the same, even if there are cosmic. So I will not show you the computation, no interest in that. The operators linking the force to the hyperstress are the same in those theories. So, true for IS there, IS for the dot, true also for the one. And now I will maybe go back to something very simple. Cauchy theory, second version, so just to understand how things work. So when L is equal to 1, the stress state due to Cauchy postulate is that the distribution on the boundary is F. So it is F for a surface, so what the NS is 2. And the NS2, and it is a zero order force, a measure. So, from the Cauchy point of view, you have something like that. From the D'Alembert point of view. Okay, so both procedures give you the fact that F2 naught is related to C1, right? C1 and L, it is a linear function. It depends linearly on the norm. So we are in the case, a very classical case. Just a remark that here C1 is a tensor of order 1, it is a vector. So it's strange in Cauchy theory to say that stress tensor is a vector. So remind that U is a scalar for me, so C1 is a vector. I am making the theory for the first component of the displacement. So C1 is the first column of the stress tensor. So I say that just to emphasize that the tensor Cn is a completely symmetric tensor. So C1 is a completely symmetric tensor, but it is a vector. So it is not relevant. I have no symmetry in C1. So the symmetry of stress tensor is not a consequence of what is going here. The symmetry which is here is just due to the symmetry of the derivatives. So it has a sense in second gradient, in third gradient theory. In first gradient theory, I have no symmetry at all. So in second gradient theory, the hypothesis is that on the boundary, you have a force on the face. A one distribution on the faces and a force along edges, and you stop there. And from the D'Alembert point of view, you have two tensors, one applying on the second gradient of the displacement, and another one applying on the gradient. Okay. And what are the relationships between those? You have C2, which is the unique tensor which represents the first order derivative, the double force on the face, which represents also the edge forces along the edge. And for the forces on the faces, then you introduce another tensor, and you have both tensors which represent the forces along the faces. And here you see the dependence with respect to the curvature here, by taking the divergence of something in which you have M. Here you have the divergence with respect to the curvature of some things. And this is really the fact that on the edges you have a term which corresponds more or less to this one. Because an edge is nothing else than a phase on which you have concentrated the curvature.
Bigger than appendices after.